Shri Kathir Anand ji.
Honorable Speaker, Madam.
Maiden speech.
I am so happy. I am so happy and privileged to debut myself to deliver my maiden speech in this August House. I come elected from Tamil Nadu state, the great home of poets, visionaries and revolutionaries, self-respect and social movements. I am elected representing Vellore Parliament constituency, the land of heritage, culture and valour. Vellore showcased the first ever large-scale violent Indian sepoy mutiny against the East India Company. Historians call it the land that debuted its first freedom struggle for our India's independence. I am proud of my town, Madam. I also take a lot of pride in mentioning that I hail from DMK party, founded with and by the principles of Tandai Periyar and Perinjar Anna, the revolutionaries who changed the face of politics in Tamil Nadu and even across India. I first want to thank the people of Vellore for their mandate and their long-standing belief in the self-respect and Dravidian principles that I hold close to my heart. I am thankful, grateful and indebted for my life to the voters of Vellore Parliamentary Constituency. Madam, all of us, if not always, must have felt this high sense of responsibility and destiny for which we have been called to be here in this house. Madam, 5 years back, my great legendary leader, Dr. Kalanjar M. Karunanidhi, the former Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, wanted me to be elected to this August House. This wish of him was made true and possible only by our leader, a patriot with a philosophical outlook, a politician with a constructive gift, an able administrator with a streak of evangelism, a reformer with a crusading zeal, a statesman and a strategist of high order. None other than our DMK party leader, Sri Muthuvel Karunanidhi Stalin, fondly called by the masses as Talabadi M.K. Stalin, our leader is one of the most powerful influences in contemporary politics. Madam, he along with me gifted to this house finest parliamentarians, our Tamil Nadu MPs, men of caliber, vision, knowledge and character that it lacked in the past 5 years. I would be cursed if I don't thank my mother, Srimati Shantakumari, and my mentor, guide and philosopher, my dad, Sri Durai Murugan, deputy leader of the opposition in Tamil Nadu, treasurer of DMK party, 11 times MLA from the Katpadi constituency. My dad is one of the intellect with the ability to accurately assess situations and resolve within the matchless time. Now, observing his son from the gallery. I also would like to... Madam, this is my maiden speech. Madam, this is my maiden speech.
No, this is not the way, no. Aap bill par boliye.
Madam, this is my maiden speech.
Bill par boliye.
Thank you. I am coming to the point.
Yeah.
Madam, my heartfelt thanks and gratitude to my parliamentary people, Sri T.R. Balu, Srimadi Kanimulji, Sri Raja, Sri Jagat Rakshagan, Sri Dayanidhi Maran, and my youth leader, Sri Udayanidhi Stalin. Coming. It's my maiden speech, so let me expose. Okay. Let me now try to focus on the government's International Financial Services Authority bill. In continuing to discuss the late bill, I would like to state, nobody has a monopoly of wisdom of knowledge. In spite of having most of the creative entrepreneurs, the most dynamic business leaders and the sharpest financial brains in this world, we are still affected by three basic problems: poverty, underemployment and foreign exchange trade deficit. Once patriotism is questioned when the actions of the state are criticized, so I have to be careful and thoughtful in my statements. The bill has challenges it has to overcome. Today, India's economy is facing a lot of challenges, that GDP growth, is declining, exports on a downward trend, unemployment is high, consumer spending is high, capacity utilization is falling, investments figures tell that the business confidence is less. The Indian economy is also leaking out its cash reserves by the liberalized remittance scheme. The percentage is also growing high. Center for Substantial Employment of Azim Premji's University tells us that 9 million jobs or above have been lost in the last 6 years. Madam, an economy, if it has to boom, the country, if it has to shine, you definitely need foreign investments and foreign money which has to come into this country. The trade has to be smoothened out. But the country is now facing big challenges. Because of that, the investors are afraid to come into this country. There is a fear both on the government as well as on the economy, whether this economy is going to stand strong or it is going to break. Madam has presented the bill before this August House, asking for to pass the bill in this House because of the International Financial Services Bill, the authority, the center has to be established in the GIFT City. But as my friends have already spoken out, the problems of this bill is the center has been established in a GIFT City. The GIFT City is already facing its failures. The failures of mobility. Why do you have to put all your eggs in one single basket kept it in Gandhinagar? Why don't you have, you always have Bombay, which is called as a financial hub, Calcutta, and also
Chennai
or Tamil Nadu, which is supposed to be the automobile and foreign exchange generating state.
Yes.
But you, but still, why is that? But the government is so clearly and politely moving it all its eggs into the northwest. Tamil Nadu is also a big hub. Tamil Nadu should have been focused on this because south always rules the financial centers. Our previous rulers, Dr. M. Kalanjar Karunanidhi, has also put in a lot of efforts to establish special economic zones in Tamil Nadu, which populated the automobile industry, software industry, as well as semiconductors industry. Lot of manufacturing is happening in south. Andhra Pradesh has got its automobile industry. Karnataka has got Infosys and software technology parks over there. Why this center has been put to Gujarat, to Gandhinagar? Earlier, when the GIFT City was established, almost 9,000 jobs and above were promised, but today the direct jobs and the indirect jobs are not that much interesting. Moreover, the GIFT City, as Madam had said, lot of institutions have to be moved in. Now we are talking about remote management. If all these centers have to be moved in, when you talk to those people, when you talk to those investors, when you talk to the banks which have been moved in over there, they are not interesting. They want to work in a area, they want to work in a state, they want to work in a city where it has been already populated with economy. But you are moving it out to a remote area. And already there are almost around 78,000 crores of investment target is set in special economic zone. The city has attracted only 9,800. How will the new bill attract more investors when there is an overall economic slump? The main partner of the GIFT is in huge financial trouble and its future fairly uncertain despite huge efforts by this government to provide needless tax breaks and regulatory concessions. The GIFT's chief executive has chosen to quit, as per the newspaper reports, only one shop in the city's market is open in the region. From what we have learned, gift today survives just because of the influence of this government and nothing else. I'm now going to talk about the authority. The provisions in the clause 21 of the chapter 8, which makes the authority bound to the direction of the policy the central government might dictate. Secondly, the complete powers of the authority are not defined, and there is a provision provided to the state to make the rules for implementation of the act by notification, making accountability meaningless. There is also a performance review committee constituted under the clause 17 of this act, which consists of two members of the same authority and nominated by the centers to review the functioning of the same authority. The fact that the members of the authority itself are in charge of reviewing the work should be extremely concerning, leading to the bias decisions. One more reason for my skepticism on this version of the bill is that it seems to give away the powers which are controlled by independent authorities to a center-controlled one. Though I support the need for such an authority that creates special provisions for the financial services, I also firmly believe that it should be independent and be able to make its own policy decisions. Madam, I want to make this very clear. I do sympathize with the necessity of having such a financial authority. In the current political scenario, I am reminded of the time the founder of our party, Perenja C.N. Annadurai, stood in the other house and quoted. I quote his words, "Correct us if you are erroneous. Convince us if you have got solid facts. Convert us to your point of view instead of compelling. Compulsion, especially through law, I did not stay in a house where are so many luminaries in this legal profession." He stopped and he said, "It is the worst form of argument." I would not like to disrespect the mandate this government has been gifted with. I just want to emphasize the importance of this opposition to debate this feasibility and accountability of this financial bill and its authority constituted. We are representing the common man, more importantly, the youths of this nation, who are now raising valid questions that to transform India into a different India, an India that is compassionate and welcoming, an India that does not lynch its minorities, an India that wants to keep religion out of politics, an India that respects dissent, an India that believes in freedom of expression, an India that questions the people in power, and more importantly, an India that works for all of us, not just the rich and the privileged. Our nation is again a nation of diversities in all order. If we are able to echo that in our decisions, then we will not get lost in the bylines trying to emphasize. One way of life, one language, or one religion, then we will never lose our way. Sir, madam, last, I'm concluding. Various factors there may be there which go to making a foreign investment in India very attractive. First and the foremost, when they invest in India, they invest in democracy. Democracy of speech, democracy to do business, and a democracy to express their views and thoughts, and the democracy to live happily in this country. When this government is attempting to crumple that democracy, then entire economy will be questioned, and therefore I urge this government, I urge through you, I urge Madam Finance Minister, that please release this government, release this country out of fear which the investors are facing now. I am so happy that now I am I am so madam, I am 2 minutes, 2 minutes, madam, madam, 2 minutes, I am concluding, madam. I am so happy that I am concluding, my 2 minutes, madam. I am 2 minutes. One minute.
Last sentence. Please finish.
Last sentence.
Madam, today is the birth anniversary of our great Tamil poet Bharathiyar. I am so happy and privileged to debut my first speech here and talk on a bill that is presented by our Madam Mrs. Sitharaman, however, from Tamil Nadu. She is one of the first women finance minister. I give my congratulations and salute to her, and I am so happy that my first speech has been debuted on her bill, and I know Madam will support this our state Tamil Nadu, which takes a lot of our attention, and we need a lot of support from you, Madam. Thank you.
Thank you. Honorable Professor Shogaturai.